tonight every single day. Call on your friends. Call on your family. And thank God is done with you tonight. I know, like I know my name, that you will never remain the same again. Even the color of your skin will change. People will see you and they will see the glory of God. They will ask you what is the secret, and you will let them know you just encountered Jesus. We are just starting. Call on your friends. Call on your friends. I'm about to call a dear man of God, one which I love and I respect so much, one which grace is undoubtedly, you know, inexplicable. He is vested with the power of God, is vested with the word of God for them now. It is vested with the power of God for what God is doing in this season. The agenda of God, he has a major part to play in the agenda of God for them now. And he is coming, he is now speaking to your life. Whatever is hanging around you is about to be with you. Lift your voice. Wherever you are, lift your voice. As I invite you to speak, you are going to be fighting. Let it flow, let it flow. Let it flow, let it flow. Let it flow, let it flow. Oh, let it flow like you right now. Let it flow, let it flow. 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 You have to give you all the praise and all the glory for the privilege you have given to us to be a part of those who called to raise the altar. What a prophetic moment that we are in our time and history. Lord, I ask that your word will be sent across the streams right now to everyone around the world that will be watching live and that will connect later on. Let this word bring life. Let this word set all paths on fire. Let this word bring us to the point of rebuilding broken down altars. Holy Spirit, this is your moment. I trust in you to do your quick work. I trust in you to do your sure work. I trust in you to do a work that cannot be denied. In the lives of your people, for all you do, I vow to return all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. For it is in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Everywhere around the world, when you put your hands together for the Lord, amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Minister Jimmy the Psalmist, for this awesome and wonderful privilege to be a part of raising this altar. 1 Kings chapter 18 is the word the Lord gave you, verse 30 to 39. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 30 to 39. And Elijah said unto all the people, come near unto me. And all the people came near to him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord. He repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. Let's keep going, verse 31. And Elijah took 12 stones, according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob, unto whom the word of the Lord came, saying, Israel shall be thy name. Verse 32. And with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord. And he made a trench about the altar as great as would contain 2 measures of seed. And he put the wood in order, and cut the bullock in pieces, and laid him on the wood, and said, fill 4 barrels with water, and pour it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood. And in verse 34 it says, and he said, do it the second time. Something is happening here. And he did it the second time. And so he did it the first time. That was Monday, 1st of July. He did it the second time, Tuesday, 2nd of July. And he said, do it the third time. And he did it the third time, and that's tonight. And the water ran about the altar. And he filled the trench also with water. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice. What time are we at this here now? The evening, the offering of the evening sacrifice, that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel, let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and I have done all these things according to thy word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that these people, my generation, may know that thou art the Lord God, and that thou hast turned their heart back again. Verse 38. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the dust, and licked up the water that was in the trench. Verse 39. And when all the people saw, they fell on their faces and began to worship. They said, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. We can see from this that the Lord is up to something by calling us to raise the altar. In raising the altar, a number of people would need to repair the broken down altars. While some are doing it for the first time, a number of people are called to repair the broken down altars. And the purpose for the altar is fire. Because at the end of the day, when the altar was raised up, when the altar was repaired, the Bible says that the fire of the Lord fell. The altar is not for decoration. It is the place that attracts the fire of the Lord. I'm speaking to a generation now watching beyond this studio. There is something God wants to do with you. But until the altar is raised, until the altar is repaired, until the altar is built on the sure foundation of revelation, there is a limit to what God can do. Hear me? The fire of the Lord is not just something we see for excitement. The fire of the Lord is reality. You know, until the altar is truly repaired, the fire cannot descend. And so in Acts chapter 2, verse 1 to 3, we see there that when the day of Pentecost was fully come, now in the preparation for the day was a process. Everybody talks about the day, but when the day came, it was a process of several days of the altar being repaired. It says when the day of Pentecost was fully come, it fully came, but it was gradually coming. There was a repairing of the altar. There was a raising of the altar. And that was in the place of separation. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, and the altars in the hearts of the people were ready, the Bible says that each one of them had flaming tongues of fire that rested upon each one of them. Look at that. For every altar, there is a fire.
for every altar there is a fire. Those people represented, so there were 120 in the upper room, there were 120 altars that were lit. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, each one of those altars caught fire. I don't know, you may have been joining from Monday, from Tuesday, all the way to Tuesday, now to Wednesday. The Bible says the day of Pentecost was fully come, but it was gradually coming. Day by day, they were getting closer. The altar was being prepared. And that's why our song every day is to be that we are drawn closer to Him. You know that song? My song every day. Father, draw me near. You know, when the altar is well positioned, when the altar, the vessel is another word we can use. When the vessel is one that is made unto honor, then the fire can truly be seen. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19 to 21. The Bible talks about vessels of wood, vessels of earth, some to honor, others to dishonor. If any man purchase himself from this, he will be a vessel unto honor, fit for the master's use, and prepared to every good work. To be fit for the master's use, the vessel must be prepared. The altar must be raised. The altar must be rebuilt. And so there are five things we find from our description of the rain. And we want to go through that. We'll have time to pray, we'll have time to worship. All in preparation for the fire falling. Hear me, fire is no more a luxury, fire is a necessity. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Fire is no longer a luxury, fire is a necessity. If you are not fired up by the Spirit, you are at risk of losing your life. The things that we see around are no more things that we can joke around with. Hear me, the only way to be preserved in a generation like this is to be set on fire. And the only way to be set on fire is to have an altar that is raised and that is kept in that position where the fire of God can fall. Now let's look at this very carefully. There are five things and we'll pray. There are five things here that we find. The first thing in verse 36. First Kings 18 and verse 36. And it came to pass at the time of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel, let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and I have done all things according to thy word. The first thing we see in raising the altar is alignment. Alignment. It came to pass at the time. So there was a time to raise the altar. Everything had to be done as ordained. Alignment. It came to pass at the time of the evening sacrifice. Alignment. Alignment. And that is where your vessel becomes one that is fit for its use. Where every sin and every weight is dropped off your life. Please follow this. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. We can begin from verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every sin and every weight. And you know, and the sin that so does easily beset us, and let us run with Jesus the race that is set before us. He says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and now is set at the right hand of the throne of God. Hear me? My generation must be very careful not to make any man our standard. Our standard must remain Jesus. Looking unto Jesus, the author. Hear me? You can't look unto him and be misaligned. You may look unto some of us, and when we make errors, you also make the same errors. But when Jesus becomes your focus, and we become those who, I'm looking for the word now, those who are coming to help part of your faith, is the life. Those who can mentor you, but are not the standard. The moment we stop following Christ, stop following us. The Bible is very clear about this. It said, follow me as I follow Christ. How will you know if I'm deviated from following Christ if you don't have him also in front of you? Alignment. This is a call to a generation to align and to realign. Yes, that's right. 1 Corinthians 11:1. Be ye followers of me, even as I follow Christ. So I'm looking unto Christ, but I'm following him as Isaac is following him. So when Isaac stops following him, then I still continue to follow him. Are you following what I'm saying? This is very, very important. There is a point and a call for alignment. Elijah had to be in alignment. If he tried that in the morning, the fire would not come down. At the time of the evening sacrifice, there was something Elijah knew about alignment. Number two thing very important is here is in intercession. The same verse 36. We see that Elijah began to pray. You can't talk about raising an altar without raising prayers. That is, it goes hand in hand. In Luke chapter 18, verse 1, it says, man ought always to pray and not to faint. It's like a parable saying, to this end, man ought always to pray and not to faint. So if we're talking about raising an altar in our generation, then the prayer fire must become the norm. Lifting up our voices in every place. Paul the Apostle said, I wish that man would pray everywhere. There is no prayer time. Beyond prayer time is a prayer life. Where everywhere you go, every corner, the moment you have a loose moment is a prayer moment. The moment you have a moment that is not engaged is a prayer moment. Elijah, we see that in raising the altar, repairing the altar, prayer was the next thing after life. Is somebody following me? I believe that's in Leviticus chapter 6, verse 12. The Bible talks about the fire and the altar burning every morning. Yes, every morning. You will lay burnt offering upon it every morning. Every morning. And the fire upon the altar shall be burning in it. It shall not be put out. The priest shall burn wood on it every morning. Any morning not started with God is a wasted day. And so it is important that every morning part of our schedule in raising the altar is the raising prayers up. I believe it's in the book of Revelation, it talks about our prayers being populated. So we raise our prayers up. We are raising the altar up. Look at how Elijah led them in prayers. They were watching as he was praying. So it was beyond an alignment only. That alignment was backed up by intercession. And then, number three thing we find is revelation. And in the same verse 36. So 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 36. 1 Kings 18, verse 36. And it came to pass at the time of the evening sacrifice. So alignment. That Elijah the prophet came there and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, let it be known to you this day that I am God in Israel and that I am thy servant. And look at this. And I have done all these things according to thy word. So it wasn't a reaction, it came from a place of revelation. I have done these things according to thy word. Raising the altar will take men and women being moved by the Spirit. Men and women who have gotten in-depth revelation about what God is doing in the now. Now hear me, not many know what God's agenda is in the now. God is raising a new generation. And that new generation must embrace raising the altar. It is not an option, it is a necessity to be relevant in this terrible season. Time is running out, and so God is looking for anyone he can find who will align. Anyone who can find who will spend time in prayer. Anyone who he can find who will spend time in the Word. It's amazing. Jesus said he wept, or it was written about him, he wept over the city because they knew not the time of their visitation. Without revelation, it's like you are blind. You have no idea of what is happening. You can even be in the midst of fire and not even know. Because the eyes of our understanding are blinded. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, the Bible talks about the devil coming to blind, to darken the eyes of our understanding. The eyes, yes, he has blinded the minds of them which believe not. Lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, to shine unto them. So in raising the altar, alignment, in raising the altar, intercession, in raising the altar, revelation. Now you need personal light. You need personal revelation. You need Rhema, God speaking to you directly on what your role is to play in raising the altar in this generation that we belong to. Number four, you find that in verse 27, that is intimacy. Verse 27 says, hear me, O Lord, hear me, that these people may know that they are God. God has turned their heart intimacy. In raising the altar, there is a call for intimacy. Beyond our public gatherings, there is what is called the secret place. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. This is very important. A call back to our secret place. Raising the altar is not a public show. Elijah didn't just come to show. He had come from a place that had born a system according to thy word. He had spent time with God. He saw how a generation was, derailed. And these were encounters that he came out with. How do I know? You don't call 400 people without meeting with God first. You don't call them to gather and tell them to call upon their God. And in the midst of calling upon their God, when you haven't yet called upon your own, you are telling them maybe your God is asleep. It takes a person who has met with God. It takes a person who has been intimate with God. He knew the time to tell them to stop screaming. Because if they had passed the time of the evening sacrifice, the fire they had never fought. But at the time of the evening sacrifice, they cried from morning to evening. But Elijah knew when it was his time to take over. It was from a place of intimacy. And then number five, which is very important, we find in verse 39. 1 Kings 18:39, and then we'll pray. 1 Kings 18:39. He said, and when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces, and they said, the Lord, He is God. The Lord, He is God. So, in building or raising the altar, there is a place for worship. And so, when they saw it, their response was worship. There is possible. Now, you can't spend time with God in the secret place and not end in worship. Ask those who have met with Him. Our response from encounters of intimacy is worship. So, raising the altar, five things. One, alignment. Two, intercession. Three, revelation. Four, intimacy. And five, worship. But if it doesn't begin with alignment, you have wasted all. And so I call this global audience, far beyond how many are connected now, but this will spread like wildfire. How many are truly aligned with God? The fire is the omen. The fire is the product of a process. Are you following what I'm saying? The fire comes at the end, not at the beginning. The day of Pentecost, when the day was fully come, then the fire came. So the fire is the product of a process. And the process begins with alignment, graduates to intercession, and then moves on to revelation, and then to intimacy, and then to worship. Then you can now expect the time before. Remember, raising the altar is not raising the structure for the sake of the structure. Raising the altar is raising a realm of practice. It's raising a resting place for the fire. Where will the fire rest? People are saying, oh, let the fire come upon me. It's good, but upon you how? It is looking for an altar. It is when the altar is raised. It is when the altar is built. And when it is built according to this standard, that the fire. I don't know about you, but like I told you, fire is no more a luxury. Fire is a necessity. It's a thing that everyone in this generation needs, and needs so badly. The reason why the church in our generation seems to be losing relevance except for a few who are really standing is because the things we say do not match with the experiences we have. And so the world is saying, where is the manifestation of the sons of God? We have heard the explanations of the sons of God, but we are waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. And God has raised such a platform like this to raise men and women that we raise an altar. When fire from one corner, join fire in another corner, and then from another corner, before you know what we have is a widespread. And that is what God said about it. Hear me? Through the streets right now, you can follow this process. If you are not aligned, you know. You don't need anybody to tell you. When the car is not aligned, all you need to do is drive the car. You will find out that there is a struggle in the smoothness of the drive of the car. God has been, oh my goodness, God has been trying to drive some of us, but He has not been able to drive us successfully because we are not properly. And so this is the call today for men and women, young and old, watching from all over the world to come to a place of alignment. I just heard it now. It's in the place of alignment that you can begin your assignment. You have been asking God for your assignment. He's asking me to tell you your alignment first. Your alignment to your assignment, and then from your assignment to your assessment. God can't assess you until you begin to do the assignment. He has called you to do. And the assignment is a product of your alignment. Alignment is a big word for a very simple thing. Are you living the life God has called you to do? Is your life pleasing to God? Is God pleased with you? Is your name written in the book of life? Because if it is, if God is pleased with you, then you are in the place of alignment. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher. How do you know you are alive? Look to Him. Are you living the way He lived? Are you speaking the way He spoke? And the way He still speaks? Are you walking in the same footsteps? This is not to judge anyone. All of us who claim to be born again, all of us who claim to be alive, all of us who are crying for help to remain alive, have had to ask ourselves very sincere questions. I'm not asking you if you serve in your church. I'm not asking you if you are a minister. I'm not asking you if you are a lover of singing the psalms. I'm not asking you if you are a lover of gospel music. I'm not asking you if you have enjoyed this teaching. I'm asking you, ultimately, so, if you are truly going to raise an altar, and you are alive with Jesus, looking unto Jesus. He remains our standard. Even Isaac is looking up to Him. And every time you look up to Him, He shows you areas you must align. As realize, as step up, He shows it to you because He is your standard. He is my standard. Raising the altar is not in the streaming. Raising the altar first is in your life. Everywhere. What we call moonlight, the moon has no light of its own. All the moon does is align with the sun. And as long as it continues to align with the sun, it produces light. The Bible calls Jesus the Son, S-U-N, of righteousness. So if Isaac aligns with the sun, if you align with the sun, what happens? You reflect light. No wonder I began by saying, I am the light of the world. Jesus said so. Then later on, He said, you are the light of the world. Not because you are generating light, but because you are light. Isaiah 60 says, arise and shine, for your light has come. That means it's coming from another source. And the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. So it's all the function of your alignment. The call to you tonight, at this point of the evening sacrifice, is are you truly aligned with God? And so we are going to pray together. Everywhere you are, the people in the studio here, this global headquarters will join us in prayer. We will pray that prayer so you hear us praying it with you. And it's a prayer of alignment. Remember, it is from your alignment to your assignment, from your assignment to your assessment. God has mighty things ahead of you and ahead of me in our generation. But raising this altar begins with a call. Wherever you are, this is the time. This is the moment. This is how altars are raised. Remember, the altar is not raised as a building that we can wave at, as a building we can admire. No, the altar is really a platform where the fire can be seen. I believe that you know, and I know, fire is no longer a luxury. It is a necessity. And if you understand that statement, you will not joke with your life. The arrows that fly by day and those that fly by night, the kind of operations of the demonic in our generation is a different one. Things happen at a frequency you can hardly explain. I heard of the story of a man, and then I'll leave us to pray very soon. I heard of the story of a man, a pastor for that matter, who corrected his assistant pastor. The assistant pastor did one or two things that were wrong. He corrected him and said, no, that is not right. So maybe in an African way, spoke to him very hard. And then went to bed. And as he went to bed, he couldn't sleep immediately. His wife was facing one side, he was facing the other side. Right from the wall, he saw the assistant pastor appear. Entered his room. And before he knew it, he lost his voice. In the midst of that satanic attack from a so-called assistant pastor, lost his voice. The next thing he had was that voice lifted him and hit him on the floor. Follow this story very carefully. It looks like a movie, but it's a real story. By time this man was trying to scream for help, his voice was taken. His wife couldn't tell. His wife too was held down by that force. The next morning when everybody woke up, it was 11 a.m. What kind of sleep is that? Nobody in the house got up till 11 a.m. By the time they got up, they met him on the floor. He had pulled on his body, a man of God. Took him to the hospital. By the time they checked him and did x-rays and did his CT scan or what have you, they came up with a diagnosis that had brain cancer stage 4. Some of the medical facts that people are given are highly demonic. Found from no sickness. By the next morning, not stage 1, not stage 2, not stage 3, but stage 4. Fire is not a luxury. Fire is a necessity. We are no more ministers with enticing words of man's wisdom, but with the demonstration of the spirit and of power. The days we are living in are not simple days. The days we are living in are not ordinary days. Now you don't have to go far to find your presence of the devil. You find him around the church. This wasn't from a witch doctor. This was from the church. From a man of God carrying a Bible and preaching. You know, that's why you need fire yourself. There are areas you enter that evil disappears upon your appearance. Yet you may not be ordained, but you are a prayer. I don't know how many people were there in the upper room, but at least the tells us there were about 120. I don't think we had 120 apostles, but men, women, every one of them carried the fire. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So your sex is not an issue. Ordination is not an issue. Recognition in church is not an issue. It is the altar you have raised. If the altar is truly raised according to the standard of scriptures, when the fire falls in location, age is not an issue. Experience is not an issue. The 120 were not there at the beginning when Jesus elected the 12. But all those that remained, oh my God, remained at the upper room. The place of the preparation for alignment, all that remained, were carriers of his power. What I'm saying today is very simple. Let's follow the process. First, there must be alignment. That's what we are about to do. Wherever you are, there are two groups of people. Those who have never raised an altar, and those who had an altar but is broken down. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Yes. We can pray together and God will give us an opportunity to raise an altar on this Sunday. Follow the process. I don't know if Minister Jimmy has seen that, but first day, second day. So that this is a 3-day program, it's not man-made. There is what happens on the first day, and you can't joke with it. There's what must happen on the second day, you can't play with it. But there is what happens on the third day. At the time of the evening sacrifice, the altar is where the fire comes from. When your life becomes an altar that is raised up to God, first beginning with your alignment, then the fire comes. Wherever you are, all across the world, let's pray together. Right? I want those in the studio to pray along with us. I will pray and then we'll lift up our voices in prayer. And let's say this prayer together. Say with me, Lord Jesus, forgive me all of my sins. Wash me in your blood. Make me the child of God. Jesus, today I align totally with you. I believe you died for me. I believe on the third day you were raised up for me. Thank you, Jesus, for I'm now born again. My altar is raised. My altar is rebuilt. No, God, let the fire fall. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Let me pray, my Heavenly Father, for all that have responded from across the world, haven't heard your word today. We ask that everyone that prayed this prayer will truly be saved. According to your word, you will do no wise things to anyone in you. Now you have responded. Now you have accepted them. Now, O Lord, that they are aligned, assigned to be a part of this generation. And I know that when the assessment is done at the end of the day, your name and your name alone shall be glorified. Jesus Christ's name. Amen. All right, I will pray in the Spirit for just 2-3 minutes, please, if you can. Let's pray in the Holy Ghost. I'm going to go to the hospital. In order to release the fire upon your altar. The altar is being raised so that the fire can descend. The altar is not a structure we admire. Yes, the altar is in the realm of the spirit, what applies and receives the fire. But the altar has first come in. You know, there's this popular song, as the bear pants for the waters, so my soul is pumping up. In the realm of the spirit, God is measuring where is Isaac's hunger level. Where is his thirst level? That's why it's dangerous to arrive in the realm of the spirit. The moment you arrive, you are finished, you are concluded. There is nothing more God can do with you. You know, the Bible talks about us limiting the Holy One of Israel. So it is possible for man to limit the Almighty. By the degree of hunger, satisfaction is a crime in the spirit. For you to get to a point where you are satisfied, oh, I've seen a lot of God, I've seen some miracles, I've seen some wonders, I've seen God use me from nation to nation. That is the end of it. Remain small in your own eyes, is what our Robert's mother told you. God will use you mightily, but remain small in your own eyes. I'm saying this to say, by the time we ask for the fire to fall, and we are praying for the fire to fall, what makes it fall upon the altar, having followed all these processes, is your hunger and thirst. Is the fire of God an option of many other options? Or is the fire of God the only option? Somebody shout the only option.
The only option.
Shout it again, the only option.
The only option.
Right? So I would your hunger and your thirst. It was John Knox that said, give me Scotland wine. That is hunger. Somebody shout hunger. Again, shout it, hunger.
Hunger.
Give me Scotland like that. Give me my generation like that. Give me fire or I die. What am I doing here without fire? What am I doing? Carrying a Bible that people cannot see. I should read a Bible that they read, manifesting the works and the wonders of God. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So that should be our cry. But let that cry be one from a place of hunger, a place of panting, a place of desperation, a place of no option. I don't have an option to this thing. I'm not going to any witch doctor to find a way out. This is my, God is my only source. I'm not looking else. I'm not looking at anyone else. I'm not looking anywhere else. He said, they looked unto him and they were like, and their faces were not as good. I said all of that to say, your hunger determines your life. The altar is being raised. You have heard those things that will help you raise the altar. But your hunger, are you hearing me tonight? Your hunger determines your fire. Your hunger determines your fire. Let me take it another notch up. If your fire tomorrow is the same as today, you are already in danger. Because sufficient to a day is the equal thereof. This thing must be increasing. That's why I said the priest must put wood on it every morning. Leviticus 6:12 must be putting wood on it every morning. How many are so desperate for fire? If you don't have another option, and you are here raising the altar, the purpose of raising the altar is for the fire to be set. Would you join me as we cry in hunger right now, just for 2 minutes? Lord, let this fire come upon me. I have no other option. Are you here at all? Lift up your voice as we pray. In hunger, in desperation. I'm going to go to the next one. So much need after hunger and desperation to cry for fire. Because your hunger and desperation has enough attracting it. Yes, there was that hunger and desperation in Niger, and after everything was alive and the process had been followed, the Bible says this is the fire of God. And the Bible says in Acts 2, verse 1 to 3, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, when there was a full alignment, when there was everything that needed to be in place, the things we looked at, there was alignment, there was intercession, there was revelation, there was intimacy, right? There was worship. This is what they did. That day fully came, that time fully came, and then the power of God came. I want you to know that you are hungry in this place to the degree that you have as a certain degree of final point. And my prayer is going to be very simple. The fire that has been contacted tonight will never go down. May that fire be upon the increase. May that fire come upon your altar. May this raised altar, these past 3 days, attract a sustainable fire in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name. I leave you with these two parting words. Two parting words. How do you know when fire has come upon your altar? Two things among others. Your speech is affected. You will be able to pray. The things you say will be altered. Because the altar is a place where people are altered. And one thing that is first altered is their speech. The Bible talks about those that are dealing with Jesus. So when they heard them, they took knowledge of them. They had been with Christ. There is a degree to which your altar has been raised, and fire has come upon the altar that your tongue is altered. One area where your tongue is altered is when the power of God comes upon your life. So that is one thing. Your speech is altered. The next thing you notice is that you begin to hear things you are scared of. Right? So when the fire comes upon you, the things God has told you to do that you have fear, you'll be able to walk in with confidence and walk in with boldness. Why? The fire has burnt the bridge. I am following you. There is no turning back. Right? So your talk will be altered. Your walk will be altered. Those are two things among others that happen when the race of God is seen. I believe that this has blessed you today. I believe this has blessed the global audience. We trust God that the raising of the altar is not a once in a while thing. We trust God that it's a posture that a generation will take. A forever posture where we will be forever alive. And then the fire of God will not only come once in a while, but it will be sustained all of the while. As these activities in the spirit continue to go on. And beyond the program, I trust God that this will be a lifestyle for the generation of people. In Jesus' name. God bless you.
Let it go!